The U.S. and Russia both failing to pass resolutions on the Israel-Hamas war at the United Nations Security Council. Russia and China vetoed the U.S. draft resolution, which aimed to address the worsening humanitarian crisis in Gaza. Russia's draft resolution, meanwhile, did not get enough votes to be adopted. Washington's ambassador to the U.N. says she's deeply disappointed by the veto.
The United States has worked to forge a consensus around a resolution that is strong and balanced. We solicited input. We listened. We engaged with all council members to incorporate edits, including language on humanitarian pauses and the protection of civilians fleeing conflict. Our resolution unequivocally condemns the heinous terrorist attacks by Hamas and other terrorist groups. It affirms the right of member states to defend themselves against the threat to peace and security posed by acts of terrorism.
A UN special rapporteur, meanwhile, continues to call for an immediate ceasefire despite failed attempts at the Security Council. Francesca Albanese says the truce is crucial as Israel intensifies its bombings of South Gaza, where most civilians from the city fled. She adds the Palestinian people should not be collectively punished for the brutal attacks done by Hamas militants.
Shouldn't a ceasefire be declared immediately to stop all this? Because I understand pursuing a legitimate goal could be to ensure Israel's security, could be dismantling the military capacity of Hamas. But what Israel is doing is not that. What Israel is doing is punishing an entire Palestinian population for what Hamas has done. This is not self-defense. Surely not under international law. And again, the humanitarian aid that I'm desperately invoking for would be supervised by the United Nations. Why can't the multilateral system have a role to play in this situation?
The chief of the United Nations rejecting accusations he's justifying Hamas attacks on Israel. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres says those allegations are false. He insists he's condemning the horrific attacks of Hamas, but a ceasefire should be on the table.
I am shocked by the misrepresentations by some of my statement yesterday in the Security Council, as if I was justifying acts of terror by Hamas. This is false. It was the opposite. In the beginning of my intervention yesterday, I clearly stated, and I quote, "I have condemned unequivocally the horrifying and unprecedented 7 October acts of terror by Hamas in Israel. Nothing can justify the deliberate killing, injuring, and kidnapping of civilians, or the launching of rockets against civilian targets," end quote. Indeed, I spoke of the grievances of the Palestinian people. And in doing so, I also clearly stated, and I quote, "But the grievances of the Palestinian people cannot justify the appalling attacks by Hamas."
Despite growing calls for a ceasefire, Israel is not backing down on its planned invasion of Gaza. In a televised address, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said preparations continue for the ground invasion. He did not provide any details, but Netanyahu said the go signal for the operation will be given by Israel's war cabinet. A war cabinet meeting was held shortly after Netanyahu's address. Israel has carried out days of intense bombardment of the densely populated Gaza Strip. The airstrikes are in response to the October 7 attack of Hamas, which killed 1,400 people in Israel. A look now at the staggering human death toll of the war in Gaza. At least 6,500 Palestinians killed in nearly 3 weeks of fighting. That toll includes at least 2,700 children. Meanwhile, a UN agency says Gaza will need tens of billions of dollars in aid to compensate for years of destruction and restrictions that have stifled its economy. Prior to Israel's bombardment, nearly half of Gaza's over 2 million population is unemployed. More than half live in poverty.
The vicious circle of destruction and partial reconstruction must be broken by negotiations of a peaceful solution based on international law and relevant Security Council and United Nations resolutions to end hostilities, and by redoubling donor support for the recovery of the war-torn economy. I think it's fair to say that without such progress, the two-state solution, which the United Nations continues to see as the only realistic basis for lasting peace, sustained economic recovery of the Palestinian economy, and the chance of a fuller life for its people, will become moribund.
At the White House, where U.S. President Joe Biden just issued a stern warning to China. He says China should think twice against attacking the Philippines, reminding Beijing that any armed attack on Manila will trigger its mutual defense treaty with Washington. Biden directly addressed Sunday's collision between Chinese and Philippine vessels off the West Philippine Sea.
Just this past week, the PRC vessels acted dangerously and unlawfully as our Philippine friends conducted a routine resupply mission within their own exclusive economic zone in the South China Sea. I want to be very clear. The United States defense commitment to the Philippines is ironclad. The United States defense agreement with the Philippines is ironclad. Any attack on the Filipino aircraft vessels or armed forces will invoke our mutual defense treaty with the Philippines.
Biden's warning comes just as Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi is scheduled to arrive in Washington, his first visit to the U.S. Capitol since 2019. Wang is expected to discuss a possible summit between Biden and Xi Jinping if the Chinese leader attends the APEC forum in San Francisco next month. A new strategy is being considered for Manila's future resupply missions to the Ayungin Shoal. The Philippine Army says it is considering using a Navy ship for transporting supplies to the BRP Sierra Madre. It's also looking at working with other countries for joint resupply missions.
We are one of the most experienced armed forces around the world. We have been fighting several wars up to today. We have been involved in wars or conflicts. So, kaya po tayo, yung mga sundalong Pilipino, ay isa sa mga pinakadalubhasa na mga sundalo sa buong mundo. Some of the our partners and allies, the more developed armed forces, they come to us to train with us.
The Philippines is also moving to counter China's alleged disinformation campaign on the West Philippine Sea.
Po'y nakaka-insulto sa Pilipino. It assumes that we have no ability to think for ourselves and to stand up for our own rights. And I think this is really looking down on us, and that really disgusts me. We are not alarmed. That is expected of China. Disinformation and information operations is in the playbook of China.
Now, China is allegedly losing interest in funding Philippine infrastructure projects. This has forced the Philippine government to pull the plug on a Beijing-backed railway project. Jackie Manama tells us more.
In a letter addressed to Chinese Ambassador Wang Zhilian, the Department of Finance expressed that it is no longer inclined to push through with official development assistance funding for the Tagum-Davao-Digo segment or the Mindanao Rail Project. The Department of Transportation had given an ultimatum to the China Export-Import Bank for the funding of what could have been the first Mindanao Railway, but it has yet to respond.
We tried to work with the Chinese, no? And we gave them, until end of the month, no? To confirm whether they will be able to support these projects that the previous government started. That's for Mindanao Railway, for Bicol South Long Haul, and for the Subic-Clark Railway.
The 100-kilometer Mindanao Railway was supposed to start construction in January 2019. This project would have put the Philippine government at a disadvantage after China's Exim Bank demanded interest rates higher than 3%. In 2022, the Philippine government considered the funding withdrawn, as China has not responded to its queries. Nonetheless, the Philippine government said it will continue with the project by looking at other funding sources for the 83 billion peso infrastructure project. Aside from the Mindanao Rail Project, other China-backed rail projects have stalled, including the South Long Haul Rail that was supposed to connect Laguna to Bicol and Clark to Subic. All of these were part of the campaign promises of former President Rodrigo Duterte. The Marcos administration is hoping these projects will soon get off the ground with new investors.
For example, the South Long Haul, no? I met with one country ambassador, no, Asia, no, to support that South Long Haul. No, he had a meeting with President Marcos the other day, no, and I had a meeting with him after that meeting with President Marcos. No, so it looks kind of very promising. We're looking at possible investors from. We can also look at ODA support. No. And government, no? So it's a combination of government, Philippine government support, ODA, and private sector support.
According to the Department of Transportation, there are no upcoming China-funded infrastructure projects under the agency. When asked if China has decreased interest in funding infra projects in the Philippines, Bautista replied,
"Parang ganun ang lumalabas."
According to a senior economic manager, a Chinese senior economic official expressed their concerns regarding geopolitical factors as the reason for the lack of progress in the infrastructure projects supported by Beijing. Maritime tension between Manila and Beijing has flared up in recent months amid China's growing assertiveness, which included the use of water cannons and military-grade laser against Filipino Coast Guard ships in Philippine waters. Jackie Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
Over now to the Capitol Hill as the U.S. House of Representatives finally gets a new House Speaker. Republican lawmaker Mike Johnson took his oath after securing 220 votes. This ends weeks of Republican infighting that left the chamber unable to respond to the Middle East crisis or carry out any of its basic duties. The post has been vacant since Kevin McCarthy was ousted on October 3rd by hardline Republicans.
In this time of great crisis, it is our duty to work together, as previous generations of great leaders have, to face these great challenges and solve these great problems. I will conclude with this. The job of the Speaker of the House is to serve the whole body, and I will. But I've made a commitment to my colleagues here that this Speaker's office is going to be known for decentralizing the power here. And we want our allies around the world to know that this body of lawmakers is reporting again to our duty stations. Let the enemies of freedom around the world hear us loud and clear. The People's House is back in business.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump facing a $10,000 fine for another gag order violation. Justice Arthur Engoron issued the fine shortly after Trump told reporters the judge's clerk is very partisan. This violated an October 3 order barring Trump from making personal attacks on members of the judicial staff. Earlier, Trump was also fined $5,000 for posting a photo of the same clerk, whom he accused of being romantically involved with a Democratic senator. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America.
We begin with dozens of state attorneys general, including California's Philam Attorney General Rob Bonta, who are taking on one of the biggest social media players, Meta. Attorneys general from 33 states filed a federal suit against Meta in the Northern District of California, while nine additional attorneys general are filing in their own states. The lawsuits claim that Meta knowingly designed and deployed harmful and addictive features on Instagram and Facebook aimed at children. These attorneys general say Meta had violated the Federal Children's Online Privacy Protection Act.
Our investigation has found that Meta has misled its users and that it's putting our children in harm's way. There's a mountain of growing evidence that social media has a negative impact on our children, evidence that more time on social media tends to be correlated with depression, with anxiety, body image issues, susceptibility to addiction, and interference with daily life.
The lawsuits come after a two-year multi-state investigation into the practices of social media companies and its impact on children. Bonta says they're also investigating TikTok. We go to San Francisco where we check out the first Philippine co-working space focusing on Philam businesses or businesses from the Philippines that want to make it here in the United States. Dynamico can be found at the Philippine Center, where the Philippine Consulate is also located. Dynamico holds its business networking event twice a month to allow entrepreneurs to get to know one another and identify opportunities to promote and collaborate. Rod Mercado of Financial Rescue LLC, which co-sponsored one of these networking events, says it is so important for businesses to synergize, especially after the pandemic.
Right now, we need every single help that we can get from the community, from the different organizations that we deal with. Financial Rescue, for example, is in the business of debt settlement, but I'm also doing fast-track lending, which is lending. During the session, I mentioned about affiliate marketing. That is the name of the game now. You cannot just survive doing it by yourself. You need other organizations to help you market your services.
And finally in sports, Filipino-American football star Cameron Bynum of the Minnesota Vikings made a pair of fourth-quarter interceptions to seal an upset win over the San Francisco 49ers, protecting a 22-17 lead. With 5 minutes left in the fourth quarter, Bynum intercepted a pass by quarterback Brock Purdy, stopping an attempted touchdown drive. In the final minute of the game, as the 49ers were making one last attempt at a go-ahead score, Bynum sealed the game with a second interception. As he was walking off the field, Bynum showed off his Philippine flag helmet decal and shared a message with his fellow Filipinos.
Every time we got the flag out, we got a ball out. It's a movie. Salama Sam Suporta, on my Kababayan. It's a movie. Thank you, Jesus.
In the next 2 weeks, the NFL is celebrating its annual heritage program, wherein players can represent countries with decals on their helmets.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.